Hello, Over the Peak. It's all fun and games, isn't it? Right, let's kick off with this PDF from the Peterson Institute. Yes, those mad buggers. This is Simon Johnson and Peter Boone, who are experts in their field. They give us this chart, which I've actually put up before, but it's I wanted a chart to be the opening thing. And these are the European central banks, actually the countries' central banks, which are still operative. They still do actually work, although the ECB does the main work. There are regional banks, the countries, and they do transfers between each other, and the ECB keeps score of the tokens that are being exchanged. Doesn't make anybody pay up, because after all, these are central banks. What would they pay up in? So the score is Germany is 326 billion euro positive, and the pigs are 336 negative. So that's what's going on behind the scenes. Right, let's get into the PDF. It is well worth reading for anybody with an interest in the Eurozone crisis. It's written a while back, so all of this is before today. Creditor nations will need to publicly admit that bailout costs may run far higher than the 750 billion euro currently committed, that is 440 billion in the EFSF, 60 billion from the European Union, and 250 billion from the IMF. Troubled banks across the euro area need larger capital injections, and euro area members need to be prepared to provide financing to troubled debtor countries for 5 to 10 years, rather than the 1 to 2 years currently implied by the current EU IMF programs. Now, these guys have worked on all sorts of IMF programs, and Peter Boone's worked in Russia on the ruble zone idea that didn't really work, because the ruble zone countries couldn't trust each other. They have experience of these sort of things. Later in the article, we get ending the moral hazard regime decisively. This is the Johnson-Boone main thing, that the world is now convinced that bondholders are always bailed out, and what are the ramifications of this? If moral hazard is to end, that is to stop the absolute guarantee of bondholders, or be substantially reduced, Europe needs to admit that many sovereigns and banks have too much debt, and the maturity structure of the debt is completely inappropriate. Members will also need to quickly reduce their needs for budget financing. In other words, deficits must stop. We do not believe this can be done piecemeal in an orderly manner. Once the decision is made to embark on default, for example, by forcing the private sector to realize substantial net present value losses on the bonds in Greece, investors will naturally assume that similar methods will be used elsewhere. Neither banks nor sovereigns in other troubled nations will be spared. Therefore, it makes sense to embark on this decisively rather than singly. This was predicting what happened over the last 2 weeks, that the Greek second bailout wasn't decisive enough, and it has now moved on to Italy and Spain, and they're just not being decisive there either. Later, to prevent financial collapse, the ECB may well choose to embark on large-scale bond-buying programs that cover many nations within the euro area while continuing to provide unlimited liquidity through the payments system. In effect, the central bank would demonstrate that it is prepared to be a fiscal bailout mechanism to Europe's troubled nations. This will prevent or limit defaults. but it will lead to a sharp decline in the value of the euro and higher inflation. The evolution of politics in this scenario is hard to predict. It is imaginable that northern nations in Europe, faced with chaotic markets, large bailout costs, and battles within the ECB, could choose to leave the euro area themselves and start a new currency. It is also possible that the nations will band together and attempt to kick out some. This can be achieved by cutting off the correspondent accounts to that nation at the national central banks. That's the chart that I opened with, that the ECB then insists that they do pay up with something. Ultimately, whatever occurs, the euro would turn into something more reminiscent of the Italian lira or the Spanish peseta than the strong Deutschmark its founders once envisioned. Well worth reading. PDF, it's not that long. Mish has been on fire lately. Mish has been brilliant, really, over the last 4 years. An incredible performance of work that he turns out. But he's really been on fire because he doesn't like Europe. He doesn't know much about it, but he doesn't like Europe because he thinks they're all socialist swine. And anything to do with central banks he hates as well. So ECB bailing out socialist swine countries, he loves to jump on. From an article of yesterday, earlier this evening I noted the ECB seeks to avert what has already happened. I cannot help but laugh out loud at some of the headlines this evening. By any rational measure, confidence has collapsed. Yet G7 seeks to avert collapse in confidence. That the ECB needs to take these actions is a 100% surefire sign that investors have lost confidence. This is ridiculous enough, but the height of absurdity is found in the G7 statement on renewed strains. We reaffirm our shared interest in a strong and stable international financial system, and our support for market-determined exchange rates. Mish says, today the G7 advocate both currency and bond market interventions, whatever it takes, they said, yet sing the praise of market-determined exchange rates. Hypocritical bastards. And before that meeting, Mish had already said of the meeting, few details have been released on the secret meetings, but I have a list of agenda items in advance. Number one, how to kick the can down the road. Two, how to make it look like we are not kicking the can down the road. Number three, how to get Germany to agree to kick the can down the road. Number four, how to silence Germany if Germany refuses to kick the can down the road. About right, Mish. Nouriel Roubini writing in the Financial Times, Mission Impossible, stop another recession, not a bloody chance. The first half of 2011 showed a slowdown of growth, if not outright contraction, in the most advanced economies. Optimists said there was a temporary soft patch. This delusion has been dashed. Even before last week's panic, the US and other advanced economies were odds on for a second severe recession. So can we avoid another severe recession? It might simply be mission impossible. The best bet is for those countries that have not lost market access, the United States, United Kingdom, Japan and Germany, to introduce a new short-term fiscal stimulus while committing to medium-term fiscal austerity. The US downgrade will hasten demands for fiscal reduction, but America in particular should commit to look for significant cuts in the medium term, not an immediate fiscal drag that will worsen growth and deficits. In other words, if you cut now, it'll only cost you more in deficits, when you have to have these automatic stimuluses, the payments that have to be made to unemployment people that always kick in. Staying with the Financial Times, and Quinton Peel has an article, Merkel tries German sang-froid amid mayhem. Panic? What panic? The stubborn reaction of Berlin last week to growing turmoil in the international financial market sounded to some like a willful refusal to face up to the danger of a new credit crunch and widening eurozone crisis. Merkel and Schauble are all on holiday. Guardian Co. UK, Bayer, the big German multinational, threatens to quit Germany over nuclear shutdown. German companies may relocate production to countries with lower energy costs. The best laid schemes of mice and men aft ganga glay. Right, where are we with this one? This is Marshall Auerbach writing for Naked Capitalism, Edith Smith's blog. Marshall Auerbach is a MMT man. There is, therefore, an opening for Moody's to gain a competitive advantage over S&P. Moody's can announce that whereas any issuer of its own currency can always make nominal payment on a timely basis, ability to pay is absolute and beyond question for the US government. Therefore, when reviewing the US government's credit rating, only willingness to pay is the consideration, and given the recent congressional proceedings regarding the debt ceiling, an entirely self-imposed constraint. Moody's could therefore put the US on notice with regard to willingness to pay and ignore the flawed economic reasoning which characterized the rest of S&P's rationale for the downgrade. Now, a little thing here that I'll put in at the end. What we've got are these deficits. Now, putting MMT aside, what is the rationale for deficits? Why do they do deficit spending? The normal purported reasoning is that you're investing in the future. So you invest now in education, infrastructure, etc. And later, the next generation will come along with their new education using this new infrastructure and make more wealth. Enough wealth that the deficits that were taken on board were deemed to be well worth taking on board. But we seem to have a problem around the world of deficits getting larger and larger and larger, with seemingly no great ability being produced from those deficits to repay those deficits. So we must ask ourselves, if deficits are proposed now, as Rubini might say, for the US, the UK, Germany and Japan, why? What is the idea? What is the rationale behind these deficits? And if it is to make things better for the future, have we done an autopsy on all the deficits that are extant nowadays to ask why those deficits have not produced a present that is capable of paying back those past deficits? Leave it with you. Bye.